know what that is? That's blood. There's blood in the air.
Golan-Globus, yeah, that's right, you're reading it correctly. It's time for a tippy-tap. Time for a tippy-tap. It's been so long since we've done one of these, because we were just marathoning episodes for a good while there.
Right.
And people were a little lax on it, taking their time. They were like, you know what, I'm going to save this one for the road trip I'm going to take in 4 years. Right. Just not going to download it, boys. Don't worry about us.
But not only is this a tippy-tap, this is our special tippy-taps, our COPPIN feel, or as they call it, over the pond. Is that what they say, over the pond?
Over the pond, I believe.
Yeah. In the old UK, they call it buggering the bobby.
Buttering the bobby.
Buggering the bobby.
Buggering.
Do they?
You know, when there's buggery going on, there can only be one man, Mr. Stuart Bannerman. Stuart!
Well, $10 is $10, so I don't mind what I do for it as long as I get paid. It's fine, guys.
What is the definition of buggery? What is it?
Just... fucking somebody up the rear end, pretty much. Oh, it's, that's what buggery means over here.
It doesn't mean anything here. Well, but, so yeah, like I said, bugger in the bobby. We're doing that.
Yep.
So you came to us with quite possibly one of the greatest episodes of Miami Vice of all time.
After Viking Bikers from Hell.
Yeah, Viking Bikers from... That is a mouthful. Why can't I say that? Viking Bikers from Mars.
From Hell.
From Hell. From Mars.
From Mars.
Wasn't the episode called Viking Biker Mice from Mars? I don't know. Maybe it was that. It's a different episode.
Oh, geez, we're off to a good start today.
We're not starting at our normal time, people.
Yeah, that's
it. We adjust for the time.
We usually take 3 hours to just talk to each other before we even start the podcast. That's okay. What kind of marathon people we are. We kick out on 42 times before we even hit record. Nice wrestling reference.
This is like the podcasting equivalent of Rocky IV. This is the bit where we're like lifting up logs and running through snow before we actually get to the main fight and punch Drago right in his face.
Right, we always said this is Golan-Globus is not a marathon. I mean, not a sprint; it's a marathon.
That's right.
It is a marathon.
That's right. Yeah. We got great lung capacity over here. But what I was trying to say is, when we cop a feel, when we bug a bobby, this is us getting into Stuart's skin. We're seeing behind his eyes. We're wearing his glasses. We've got his tiny little name shiny pulled back just for this episode. Where did your life with Miami Vice begin?
Oh, my life with Miami Vice began when I was about 17 years old. So this is when the show aired. So Miami Vice started in 1984. I didn't see it then. I probably jumped in around season two, which would have been around 85, 86. I had the Phil Collins albums. I had sorts. I had the music's fantastic to this show. And I'm not the first person to mention this, but I prefer Don Johnson as Burnett, his alter ego, rather than the cop thing. But I find Miami Vice just such a cool show. Maybe not all episodes are super cool nowadays because it's kind of dated in a lot of ways, but you know, Jamaican accents being one of them. But the episode that we're going to talk about tonight is part of a multi-episode story, which a lot of TV shows didn't do then. Sometimes you got two-parters, like, you know, $6 Million Man and the old A-Team thing and whatnot. But generally, they were standalone episodes. But Miami Vice did this thing, which was a storyline that arced over a few episodes. And this episode that we're going to talk about tonight is one of them. So that's my all-time favorite. I can't even say this is my favorite episode because I actually recorded all the episodes within this story arc and cut the credits out and turned it into a stupidly long movie and had it on VHS. And I used to, and I'm not even kidding, watch it weekly.
That's awesome.
What did you feel about the Miami Vice movie that came out a few years ago?
I love that movie. I was really apprehensive when I heard they were doing it, because I'm like, you can't remake Gold. It just doesn't work. You cannot possibly match what it was. But then I saw the trailer. And the trailer, it looks more modern than this series does. It has a bigger budget. But it kept the spirit of the series for me. And I went to the cinema to watch this, and it was like Top Gun Maverick to me, which was like, I came out and I'm like, oh my God, that was amazing. I could easily have turned around, gone back in and watched it again. But yeah, I'm a big fan of the movie.
Now, one of the things I know about the original series is that they went out there with, you know, all the production value, like sets, the wardrobe and all that. Did that? I've heard people in your guys' age group that have talked about how they wanted to change their whole idea of their fashion because of this show. Did it have that effect on you when you were, I think you said 16, 17 when you started?
I looked at Don Johnson back then going, his style is amazing. His look is amazing. His hair, perfect. His attitude, perfect. My God, I would love to dress like that, but I'm never going to be able to pull it off, and I'd get bullied and beaten up all the time. So no, I never did it. I did have the black sunglasses and you know, the ponytail periodically. and that was from this episode. It was like, my God, that's amazing. And I made the mistake of telling my partner Annette, oh, I had my hair like that. So every time Don Johnson pops up, she looks at me, laughs, and went, was that what your ponytail was like? We were watching this episode today, and there is the son of the drug dealer who has also got a ponytail and a big bushy hair. And she went, was that like yours? I'm like, how dare you? No, it wasn't. So I had to rewind it to a shot of Don Johnson. I'm like, that was mine, a tiny little ponytail, cool looking one, not like a Tina Turner with an elastic band in the back of the head.
Now, I don't know how closely you pay attention to fashion that's happening, hair fashion specifically, that's happening over here in America right now, because the curly mullet is very back in.
Is it? Oh, no.
Yeah. So they'll do the shave sides, and then they'll let the curly mullet grow long. And that is a big thing nowadays. And so when I saw Miguel, I was like, if people knew about Miguel, you would see that. And he did like the, all I can think of is Beauty and the Beast. They would do like the pony.
With the ribbon.
Yeah, with the ribbon. The ponytail cinched off with the ribbon. But this brings us to one of the points I wanted to make about this very fucking episode, is that the big players in this stand out. Yeah. I'm talking Elgato. Holy shit. We're going to do 9 hours on Elgato's fashion alone. Yeah. Dolomite Design would not an approval at his outfits. Then you have Cliff, who I was like, who the fuck is this guy? And then Cliff ended up being a big part of the episode. He stood out. He looked manic. He looked
played by Max Headroom.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
He gave me some, like, he could have been on Justified and fit in with some of that kind of riffraff.
Yeah.
I loved his look. Then, of course, you have Sonny. Sonny stands out. That ponytail, of course. Yeah. Tubbs with the beard, and he's looking broken. He's got
He suits a beard.
Yeah.
He does, because majority of the episodes, the earlier ones, he's just no beard. And when he gets the beard, you're like, that kind of works.
I was reminded in the flashback, because we haven't done Miami Vice in so long, I kind of forgot what these guys look like normally. So watching this episode, I was like, oh, who are these badasses? Tubbs, of course, stands out. And then Miguel stands out. That's the son with the ponytail, ribbon tied off, giant hoop earring. Now, I left a couple people out because I didn't think they stood out as much. And I believe her name was Celeste.
Yes.
She was just kind of there.
Yeah,
I didn't think she really popped out. And I didn't think Oscar, Miguel's dad, stood out that much. I thought he was just kind of there as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think Celeste was more of a chess piece, wasn't she, really? With, you know, Sonny was obviously using her to work his way up and all that sort of stuff. But I thought Deborah Fuhr, who played Celeste, I thought she was good. I remember her from To Live and Die in L.A., which I recently rewatched as well.
Interesting, because that might be a future episode.
Are you a Freakin' Act too? Do you like William Freakin?
I was devastated when I woke up and Bill Freakin had died, because he and I, Bill Freakin and I, were Twitter buddies.
Oh,
He was one of my many, many people that used to sort of like the odd tweet and retweet and stuff. So yeah, no, I'm a huge freaking fan.
Now, did you also do what Murray did and just go on a freaking wormhole and just watch all of his interviews and grab a bunch
Yeah.
He's got me doing it now, too. I'm just, like, picking him out. He did the Criterion, you know, like, looking at the picking out movies from the Criterion collection. I watched that.
He did, years ago, he sat down with Mick Garris and did an interview with him, and it was never released because... I mean, Mick Garris has since released it. So if you go into Mick Garris's Twitter feed, it'll be on his post-mortem podcast. But Friedkin just sat down on this interview and destroyed The Exorcist 2. He was like, it's a piece of shit. Not even a film. And then Mick Garris is like, uh-oh, because this is many years ago. But it's a wonderful interview. I'll send you the link in private
X/Twitter DM,
but it's really funny.
Oh, man.
Doesn't everybody agree The Exorcist 2 was awful? I don't know
how that's kind of personal. Of course it's. Yeah. Awful. It's crap. Yeah, but you generally don't find a filmmaker publicly going, it's a piece of shit on an interview. So that's, you know, that's pure gold.
Yeah, usually they play Hollywood a little bit more.
He was a maverick. He did what he wanted.
Yeah, he was.
Loved it.
But yeah, great guy.
Back on topic to this episode, mm-hmm. We do have a drug family. Like we said, we have Miguel, the son of Oscar. And I love this. Murray, we're going to talk sports for a second. Okay. Just 1 second. But Murray is an old school sports fan. He hates the analytics. Yeah. That's Miguel. Miguel's analytical. He's constantly got flow charts.
He's a college boy. Graphs. He comes from the school of hard knocks that Sonny and Oscar
can. Right. Miguel is a total by the gut dealer. He's just like, no, we strike when I say so because I make the call.
Oscar is.
Oh, yeah. Oscar. I said Miguel. My bad. So I love that because it's old school philosophy against new school philosophy. He's like, no,
it's experience versus book learning.
Yeah. The math doesn't lie is what Miguel keeps trying to say. 2%, Dad. 2%. So I loved getting that clash because they got that perfectly. And we didn't even talk about this. Don Johnson directed this episode.
Yeah.
And we got to bring up one big point about Don Johnson's directing style. I don't know what else he directed, if he went on to direct anything else. He's a student of the speeds and scale. Did you guys see that in this episode?
What?
Don Johnson being a student of the speeds and scale.
I would love to say I know what that is, but I have no clue what that
is. Well, Stuart, you will know. You're going to understand by the end of this episode. I was going to ask if you use this Feet and Scale in your films, but apparently there's some room for improvement if you're doing any kind of love scenes.
I know that Don only directed one more thing, and that was an episode of a TV show called The Marshal in 1995. Other than that, he directed nothing.
He didn't get to direct any Nash Bridges. Nash Bridges? Yeah.
No, Nash Bridges.
That's unfortunate. It sounds like I'll have to convince both of you guys he's a student of Sveetson. So, because what I saw when I was watching this episode was the fog being used
fog and smog.
Smog. And then we even have a little bit of an Oedipus complex happening in this episode.
Yeah, we do.
Stuart agrees.
Yep.
I think we do. And to Don Johnson, again, just.
Did they fuck their parents in this movie?
We'll get there.
Okay.
Yeah, well, it's kind of. Via the scenic route.
They modernized it, you know, but it's a tale as old as time. And then we even have, because we've got all these people, you know, trying to bring unions back. They try to unionize drug dealing in this episode.
Yeah, they try to bring socialism to our capitalistic society. We're not having that.
Well, they are the guys that do all the work. Why shouldn't they share in the profit?
That's right. But I am all out of opening notes. Are we ready to get into this, or do you? Murray's got something.
I want to say, I mean, you grew up in dreary England. Was Miami just the most exotic place?
Ever? Yeah, of course it was. It was. You know, here in England, we saw shows that were based in like LA, so you got the A-Team and stuff like that, and MASH. Then we got New York shows, which you like.
It was set in Korea,
but you know, it was filmed in LA, and we knew that. And then you got shows that were in New York, and you're like, well, do I really want to, you know, go out at night and get mugged and hope that Charles Bronson's on his way out for some low-fat milk or whatever and saves my life? And then we got Miami, which was just all glitz and glamour and chainsaws and drug dealers and stuff. But, you know, it looked glitzy and glamorous and looked nice.
So you were just man, if I could just live there instead of here.
Yep.
Did you ever make it to Florida or Miami?
No, I've done California. I've done New York. I have not yet made it to Miami, but I will one day.
Okay. You got to be ready to drive a car. Like New York, I know you could get around with public transit. California, maybe.
Yeah, shit.
But well, Florida.
He's been to California.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Florida, you definitely.
Well, I think we talked about this before, but you live in England, but you're originally from Scotland, right?
Yep.
You're a Highlander.
I am.
You say that.
I am.
Technically, you're immortal.
Yep.
When did you move to England? How old were you?
I was 15.
Oh.
And you were on your own?
Yeah, I moved on my own. Yeah. From the age of 13 for about a year, I lived on my own. And by that, I mean on my own in a house for like a year. And then I had to move back in with my mother and a boyfriend. And then they decided, you know what, this house isn't big enough for all three of us. So you can just basically leave. So I'm like, okay, then. So I moved down to England and lived with my aunt for a bunch of years. So yeah, that's a very brief backstory on how I ended up with this weird shitty accent that has no real. It's an odd one.
Yeah, I was thinking about it. So when you were little, that's English accents, I have no problem with. Irish accents, I can understand. Yeah. Scottish accents are rough. I mean, if you got a thick one, did you have a thick one?
No,
when you were little kid?
The best way to sum it up is my accent was probably like Ewan McGregor, but not when he was in Trainspotting, just Ewan McGregor when you hear him.
Yeah, so, that's a perfect example, because over here in Trainspotting, they had to have subtitles for us.
Yeah.
we got so offended by that in the UK. We're like, what the fuck? Why can't I understand what's going on? What? We need subtitles. It's like, don't know why they can't understand what you're saying. Yeah. Who knows?
So we've officially copped a feel now.
Yeah, we've learned a little bit more about Stuart.
Yeah, so we are ready to break our way into this episode, and we are scanning.
Well, before we get into the episode, we got to remember.
I'm just hoping you guys have pressed record, otherwise we're going to go through this all again.
Yeah, let's go check that.
No, I'm off. Power's out.
Technically, we're in the middle of a story. So we're in part three of this story. Now, because we never do our research. We didn't watch the first two episodes. Like you said, Stuart, this is very innovative because you would get the, I think it was Dallas was the first cliffhanger like episode, like end of the season, and you'd have to wait the whole summer. And this was even more because this is like I said, part three. So there were two parts on the season four, the end of season four of Miami Vice. Before this. So we want you to give us the Reader's Digest version, quick recap. What do we need to know that happened in those first two episodes?
Well, it was kind of a bad run for Sonny Crockett, because you've got season four, episode 20, called A Bullet for Crockett, in which he gets shot and ends up in a hospital bed. And so the entire episode is people thinking he's going to die, and it's flashbacks to like bits of previous episodes. So they obviously couldn't be bothered filming anything that week. So it's like, dig the clips out. Sonny gets better. And then in episode 21 of season four, Don Johnson is struggling to have a date with his wife because she's a very, very famous singer, played by Sheena Easton, who's also a very, very famous singer. And she gets assassinated on stage.
Whoa.
So Sonny Crockett obviously hits the whiskey bottle and, you know, he's not too happy about that because his wife's dead. Finds out she was pregnant at the time. So that sends him off into an even bigger spiral. And then that ends that episode. So the next episode, episode 22 of season four, so we're March 1990. I guess that's UK dates for me. And Don Johnson decides, right, I'm going to go, well, Sonny Crockett decides, I need to get to work because I've had too much time and I've run out of whiskey. So what I'm going to do is go to work and I'm going to go on this very dangerous drug deal on a nice, big, expensive yacht and take all these drug dealers down because that's what I do. And I look
so
cool doing
it. Is this undercover? Like Castillo doesn't even know about this? He's just
No, because Castillo knows about this and Tubbs knows about this, played by Philip Thomas. So they know that he's back at work. And are you sure you're going to be able to do this, Crockett? Because, you know, you've had a rough week, a rough couple of episodes. I'm fine. I know what I'm doing. Stop babysitting me. I'm just going to go out on this boat and I'm going to put these two drug dealer families together and then you can all arrest them. Brilliant. Easy done. Just something he's done in many episodes over many seasons. Yeah. However, somebody has planted a bomb on this boat and the bomb goes off. Now, just before the bomb goes off, and by that I mean a few seconds, Sonny Crockett jumps off the boat, so he's not killed. However, he does wake up in a hospital, all bandaged up. He's had a smack to the head, and the doctor says, look, I don't want to get into your business, but I know what you do. I know you're a drug dealer, and your name's Burnett. And then Crockett's like, oh, okay then, guess I'm a drug dealer, and my name's Burnett. And he just runs off and becomes like an amazing drug dealer. In the series, obviously, drug dealers aren't amazing, but in the series, they're fucking awesome. So he just runs off and he joins one drug family. And it is the brother of El Gato.
The Manola family.
The Manola family. So Julia Roberts is in that episode. That's one of the first things I ever saw Julia Roberts in. So she's in it. The police find out, oh my God, this crazy sandy-haired guy is running around pretending to be the drug dealer. Holy crap, Crockett's alive. We need to try find him. But Crockett's a drug dealer. So what are you going to do? And then it ends with that episode where Sonny Burnett, who I'm now going to refer to him as, guns down an undercover policeman and drives off in a speedboat. And it comes up the executive producer, Michael Mann, all while Tubbs is on the pier going, Sonny, as the boat drives off.
What an amazing cliffhanger. You'd have to wait 3 to 4 months to get the resolution of that back in the day.
That's fucking
binge watching. You're just like, fuck, all you're thinking about. I'm sure that's all you were thinking about.
Yeah.
It's just like, what happened?
It's amazing how I did not see those prior episodes. I just jumped in right here in this. I was swept up. I was invested from the get-go. I thought that's lost.
What it was going to be. Like, they were throwing us in the middle of the story. I had no idea that this was a continuation. So I was like, oh, it's going to be one of those things where by the end of the episode, they'll explain, like a Tarantino type thing.
Yeah.
They like, you know, the time shifts. But right. No.
Exactly. Yeah. It was done so well. The storytelling, I was like, wait, do they know he's in here? And there's like the confrontation we'll get to. And it's like, oh, okay. So he's not, but I didn't know about all the amnesia and everything.
Yeah. I would definitely recommend going back watching the previous one because it's great. It's really good.
I'm excited to check this out. I do want to, you know, get the thrilling.
Is there El Gato in it?
No, there's no El Gato. El Gato, El Gato! He makes his appearance in this. It's mostly Manolo that's in the previous episode. So, this is the one that introduces Cliff King, played by the genius who behind Max Headroom. All that craziness.
It's all right, great. So we got the backstory. Now, Griff, now's your time.
Now's my time.
Sink your teeth into this episode. What was that's the title of it again?
Hostile
Takeover. Okay.
Yep. So we're scanning those sweet streets of sunny, are they Miami? Is it?
They're in Miami. Yeah.
Of course they're in Miami.
It's not sunny, it's nighttime.
Yeah. Well, I didn't say sunny, did I? Yeah, I said sweet streets.
No, you said sunny, sweet streets.
Oh, okay.
Maybe you're talking about Sonny Burnett.
Maybe I was. Who knows? Yeah. Anyways, we got the sweet tunes, starting to play up. Then you hear the DJ come over it. I am the doctor, and you are to report to the dance floor. And sure enough, we got all these people dancing around. What are we doing here?
It's a birthday party, Griff, for Celeste. Side piece of Oscar Carrera. Drug lord.
She's must be friends with Jesse the Body Ventura because she had one of his headpieces.
Yeah,
on.
She had like a beaded kind of headdress on.
Yeah, it's confusing.
And it's very 80s. We got a lot of glittery shit. The beautiful people, Griff, of the 80s. Everyone dreamed of being a part of this. It's very douche cool.
Did you think, Stuart, when you were going to like adult parties, there's going to be like more fire twirlers at them?
Yeah, I wanted to be fire twirlers and. To this day, I've never been to a party with a fire twirler. I've tried to be the fire twirler, but I can't get a lighter to work. It just, I don't know whether it's the breeze or the just crap weather in England, but so my days as a fire twirler are not starting really. It's quite
depressing.
Well, isn't it everyone's dream to be at a drug lord's birthday party?
For real?
Yeah. My dream was to be hosting that party, not be at a party.
All right.
I wanted to be El Gato.
Perfect segue, because as people are partying, a limo pulls up and a mysterious character gets out by the name of El Gato, which of course in Spanish means the cat, or in French means the cake. He's the cake to me, because he takes the cake.
He takes the cake. And
he's eating a lot of cake.
In English, it actually means I'm going to wear my sunglasses at night. I know I can't see anything, but I look cool. That's
He is wearing the shades that, again, this show saw the future, because people are wearing the shades now in sports that he was wearing in this episode.
Right. He's kind of a incredible. Let's explain the guy for the listeners. He's a DeVito-esque.
100% DeVito-esque.
It's like basically Danny DeVito with a mustache.
It is. Yeah. He's got I don't know how to explain him outside of Danny DeVito.
I think if you're to take Danny DeVito as the Penguin in Batman Returns and give that character 16 tons of cocaine, I think that's probably what El Gato might be.
I think his name is like John Prito or something like
John Polito.
Polito, yeah. And so you will know this guy if you watch this episode. He is in everything. You have seen him somewhere. He's in Big Lebowski. He's in this movie, that movie. He's everywhere. And he, again, gets out. One of those people, your eye is immediately drawn to him. He takes a big whiff of that humid Florida air. Blood is in the air.
Can you smell it, boys? And all his minions smell the air with him. They're down with the Gato.
Down with the sickness.
Do you not find his henchmen are just really weird? Can you smell that? Yes. No, you can't. You can't smell anything. You want to be friends with El Gato? Yes. Kill everybody. Okay. They're just like, they are like the penguins at Batman Returns.
Well, they are dressing like kind of tuxedo-esque kind of. Yeah,
that's right.
There you go.
So we know some funny business about
the. And you know, El Gato is always wearing gloves.
Always.
So always have germ problems.
Can't wait to talk more about Gato and his fashion.
This is his most subtle look, is in the beginning.
Right. This is his murder look. Like, he might have to break a sweat here. So.
I think, Griff, if you ever die, God forbid you don't die before me. If you do, I'm going to wear El Gato's funeral wear.
Please. And do exactly what he did to that coffin to me. Make a whole scene. Definitely live stream it, though. And you have to have one of the fucking selfie cameras, and you do that. Yes. You know, you're the main character at my funeral, okay? You have permission.
Yes. All right, so now we've established some shit's going to go down. Blood is in the air.
Now,
I can feel it coming in the air tonight.
If you were listening to me before, I told you there's going to be this old school, new school drug business, you know, mindset coming into focus here. Because we got Oscar, that's daddy.
Right.
Oscar, what are we, Manola?
Carrera.
Carrera, yeah.
Okay. And he's refusing. This is his lady's birthday party, so he's all fun right now.
Right, because we got his son Miguel, who is a Hispanic Kramer, basically.
Yes, that is a good way to put it.
He has Kramer's hair,
yep.
But to make it worse, he has a poofy little poodle ponytail held together by a ribbon. He always has ribbons. He's like some like fop from like 16th century France or some shit. Should be wearing like short pants with like stockings up to his knees.
Yes.
Kind of thing.
And the other thing I love about him, color coordinates the ribbon. Yes. So the funeral scene, it's black. Yes. This scene, it's white. He's wearing like purple later. He's got a purple. Love this kind of detail. Love it.
Right. And he it's him and their concierge, their like lawyer. They're like, they want to talk business.
Right. Miguel wants the business to do not just good. He wants it to do better. He's like, shareholders, stop paying your employees so much money.
Diversify.
We got to, the money should be at the top and then we trickle it down. So he's trying to say all this, but Oscar's just like, no, not today. Your mother wouldn't want this. So go ahead and give your mother here a kiss.
And she's even playing along and she's like cock teasing him a little.
Oh my God. This is the first whiff of that, fog you get to see in this episode. Yeah. It's not the laser light show going on in the club. It's not to make the fire even cooler. It's the fog.
Right, it's to manipulate Miguel.
Yeah.
So Oscar heads out.
Because Miguel blows up. Right. She's not my mom.
My mother's dead.
Yeah, my mother's dead. And then he kisses Celeste on the lips.
Yeah.
Strange situation here.
Yeah. Not even a peck. Not even a peck on the lips. That's like a full-on smooch.
Yeah.
That Oscar doesn't even seem to either pay attention to or just doesn't see.
Right.
This is a Bermuda love triangle. It's so fucking weird.
Yeah. This is what happens. It's a cute. No, that's not going to work. That doesn't work.
So he walks out to get some air and bumps into dashing, handsome man, Sonny Crockett. Or should I say,
Sonny Burnett.
But Don Johnson looking great. Suit fits him. Clean shaven hair, not one hair touching those ears. You know why? Because he's got it pulled back into that little baby Nang chin.
Mm-hmm.
Hell yeah.
Oh, yeah. And this is where we get the conversation. Oscar, what do I do with these kids? I don't know what to do with my son. I send him to college. $40,000 every week. He's so smart. He's so analytical, but he just doesn't understand.
He didn't go to the school of hard knocks like you and me, Sonny. And Sonny smirks.
Got
to
have that kind of conversation.
Right.
Always have to have the street talk. So, you know, like, Sonny is always going to play the negotiator. He's always going to keep things even. You know, when you got Miguel going hot and Oscar going cold, he's going to bring them to the same medium temperature.
He's going to make him lukewarm. Yeah.
Yep.
He's the Derek Smalls of the drug trade.
So, you know, he says, this is what you did for your son. This is what you wanted. You wanted him to be college educated. You got to understand he's going to have his own opinion. And so Oscar's like, you're right.
Yeah, Sonny, I mean, Oscar defers to Sonny a lot, more than to Miguel. Yeah.
Yes.
So, yeah. So there's also that tension.
They're sort of the same generation, aren't they? So, yeah, obviously, they both came from the school of hard knocks. And you look at who Oscar's surrounded by, nobody quite like. Maybe Cliff King, but he's to him in a little bit. But
yeah,
right. So you got to confide in the right people. And Oscar knows how to do that. You're not so sure about Miguel knowing how to do it. He's really trusting his books as opposed to, you know, his gut, his understanding. So, you know, Oscar tells him, Sonny, I want to see you inside in that beautiful suit, dancing, twirling fire, clapping butt cheeks. Do something. I want to see some action out of you, bud.
Fucking kiss my girlfriend like everyone else is.
Yeah, yep. Get in there. She's got the booth lined up, 25 cents.
Speaking of his girlfriend, we go back to the party, and the cake comes out. Have you anyone ever seen one of these cakes? I've seen these in like sitcoms a million times.
We saw it in a Steven Seagal movie.
Yeah, yes, Under Siege. Yeah, which I think Sensei Seagal watched this episode because the ponytail came out, the big cake.
Yeah,
you know, I think there's more to. I expect to read about that in this Last Action Hero book that I'm reading. There'll be something about Sensei was sitting down watching Miami Vice one day and he decided, here's my career.
Yeah, I think
that's
you're
me.
Right.
Yeah.
It's like that ponytail as he's like boring his hands through his thinning hair.
Was he thinking I jump out of the cake and all my muscular physique, or did he realize I am not?
He was just looking at the Nang Chen.
He was focused on the Nang Chen. So he's like, someone else can pop out of the cake.
So yeah, so a giant cake rolls out. And of course, there's a stripper in it. If you ever see a giant cake in a TV show or movie, you know there's a stripper.
Gotta be.
Yeah. And since it's for Celeste, it's a male stripper.
That's right.
I could tell by looking at him. He's 6 feet tall, at least.
At least.
You're not allowed to strip in America if you're a man.
You can. You just can't be a Chippendale certified stripper. And that's the pinnacle. That's when
he wants to be a regular stripper.
Exactly. You don't get that union pay because, of course, Chippendale dancers are unionized. So you get a base pay of $100K, and you're going to make 10 times that stripping. All that...
I wonder if one of these strippers who's been hiding in a cake, because obviously they've got to wheel the cake out and put it in position, and they're going to be in there for a little while. I wonder if any of these strippers have ever farted whilst they've inside the cake and how to deal with that.
Man,
I was just thinking about the fact that he was already stripped. He was just wearing a Speedo.
Yeah. Yeah, really.
He left nothing to the imagination.
You got
to
have a robe on or something to take off, play on the imagination a little bit.
Like
an
apprentice stripper. Like,
yeah.
If he laid on his back, his dick could be the candle. Blow the candle out. That's probably a different movie. Maybe that's a different tippy top.
This isn't a sheet cake, all right? This is this is like three tiers. You can't do that.
That is a different movie, Stuart. Right. That's a different movie, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes.
50 Shades of Icing. That could work.
So yeah. Don Johnson knows the audience, their attention is on this stripper. Man, men are checking out his physique. They're like, shit, I could probably get those chiseled abs. And women are like, oh, shit, those are chiseled abs. Are they going to blow a candle off his
Everybody's
cock?
Everybody's marveling at his great tan.
That's right. Oh, great tan. Yeah. But it, for the people who, you know, aren't fooled by magic, you know, sleight of hand type stuff, you realize there's people moving in to the background.
We cut back to the kitchen area, yeah. And these Elgato's goons are just walking through. They're dressed as waiters, and they're pulling out their Uzis.
Yep. And then, while standing there in front of the people who are about to gun down, they then decide to take earplugs out of their pockets and put them in at that moment. Why you wouldn't put them in 5 minutes before, I don't know. It's a bit of a mistake there, guys. So if you're going to be an assassin, put your earplugs in earlier.
Must have been a good song on, you know?
It was Underneath the Radar by Underworld was the song that this episode opened with.
You did? Okay. I was going to ask you that, and then I forgot because
perfect
of that derailed.
Band's called Underworld. Perfect Underworld. Music for these guys.
Oh, good call. Yeah.
So they just walk out, immediately fill the stripper full of lead. They just blow him away.
Yeah, they were really offended. Back in this time, you couldn't be attracted to a man and get away with it. So.
Well, yeah, we see that later on, too. There's
right.
Also some more.
So, of course, they were starting to have some of those feelings. They're like, I gotta suss that right out of here. And so they killed the man first.
Right. Yep. And they just opened fire. And so everyone scatters, but not Sonny. He immediately goes into combat mode.
Yeah.
He leaps on the cake that's on wheels and slides across.
Ooh, I think Van Damme stole this for a lot of his movies, too, because he slides on shit all the time in his movies to shoot people.
Takes out three of the killers.
Mm-hmm. And we noticed something about how he was shooting. Stuart, did you notice how he was shooting?
Well, I know from having seen Miami Vice anyway, he's got a military background, so that's where that just kicks in. He does that little cool shimmy across the floor, and then takes somebody out. So he's soldier mode.
Yeah. It was definitely military style.
It's military, yeah, exactly. So, the gun had a crew cut, after all.
And a ponytail.
With a matching ribbon.
Yeah. No shoes. The magazine wasn't wearing any socks, which was quite good.
And then, bam, we go right into credits. People, we haven't even started the episode, technically.
That is
It's like an average Golan-Globus Theater episode. You get like fucking a half an hour of this build-up.
Build-up.
Amazing build-up.
Facts. Interesting.
Because I know this episode like the back of my hand, we're actually 6 minutes into this episode. Just six so there minutes. You go. 6 minutes.
And everybody is on the edge of their seats. Like I said, all these characters are jumping out, just telling you, come on in. 40 more minutes of fucking awesome television await you on the other side.
And on the other side of those credits, we're back at the police station. We have Edward James Olmos, Captain Steele. And where he's given us people who haven't seen the other episodes a little rundown of what happened.
Right. This is the perfect rundown. It's like a 1 minute rundown. We've got the old dot matrix computer printout, green faces just blurted out there on a computer screen, and everyone's studying every crevice in this man's face. Who are these people?
Well, we have the credits. We see the face of Oscar Carrera, and we learn that he had taken out the head of the Manola family. With his mechanic, Cliff King, played by Matt Frewer, Max Headroom. He's got the crazy hair. I was just watching that role. I was like, man, you imagine how great Wings Hauser would have been as Cliff Griff?
That would have been good, but I think the subdued nature of this Cliff works out perfectly for it.
So we learned, like, this is what caused this hit, because this was payback. For the Manola family, because Elgato's brother had been killed. Did Sonny kill him?
No, I think that happened off screen because it's like in the previous episode, he was hanging around with Manola, and then.
Well, what am I talking about?
Episode,
they explain Cliff King did it. What am I talking about? So Cliff did it, and then we see beautiful fucking Kramer hair. It's Miguel. He's just his Carrera son. He's a college graduate. But he's a bit of a hothead. You know, and we're like, okay. And then we see Elgato. This is Carrera's ultimate nemesis. He wants revenge for his family, his honor. And he's also trying to move in on Carrera's territory. There's not room enough for two drug dealers in Miami. It's either Carrera or it's Elgato.
That's right. And then the room, we break away from the monitor. We're done looking at our criminals. We see that we have like three or four different cops in here.
The regulars. I don't know. Name them off, Stuart.
Oh God! Well, all the
Two girls and there's like
two girls. Gina. You've got over to say Edward Almos is Castillo, lovely guy. I got to hang out with him. He's amazing. You've got Trudy, who Tubbs hangs around with now and again, and then you've got Stan Switek, who's one of the guys.
And they're bickering over what's going on with Sonny. We can't trust him anymore. He's on the other side now.
Right.
Well, he's in the underworld.
They bring up that cop that from the previous episode, the undercover cop Sonny had shot.
Oh.
But the guy is like, that guy was crooked. He had it coming. Sonny did the right thing. Right.
Still a cop. He was still a cop.
Right.
So you can't go shooting him then.
Castillo, he's cool, but he's still by the book. Yep. So he's just like, still a cop. So Tubbs, so they go, all right, guys, break up.
Yeah.
Castillo goes to his office. Tubbs follows him.
Gets private word.
And he's like,
they're going to talk about the club shooting.
Yeah, there's an eyewitness. Tell me if you've heard this before. Sandy blonde hair, 160 pounds.
What?
Shot military style.
It's got to be Don Johnson. Has to be. Brown hair. Shot. Yeah, definitely. Definitely Crockett.
Not brown hair. Sandy. Blonde hair.
Yeah, we're talking Miami, Florida. No one else has sandy blonde hair. And is 160 pounds.
And carries a gun.
And
shoots the military stuff.
Right. Those three distinct things have never. There's no one else in that cross section.
So I mean, Tubbs. They show it later in this episode. Tubbs admits to Crockett he loves him. So this is hurting him.
Yeah,
this is happening to Sonny.
Don Johnson again, fantastic work storytelling, weaving in and out past, future, where we're at now, where we're at that. It's amazing. We're getting the flashbacks and everything. Wonderful job. But we got to cut to a nice brunch scene here.
Right, we're at Oscar's place. We're having a meeting.
And Oscar, we've been talking about, Oscar is the drug dealer who's like, we're going to have a good time. We're going to get our bellies full here because you think better on your belly. And when you do your thinking with your gut.
Right, you got to feed that gut.
You need it fed. Yeah. So he's got oranges everywhere, everybody. Florida, after all.
Right.
That's the thing, Stuart. When you fly into Florida, you just get bushels of oranges.
Right. It's a new block, apparently.
He's just cutting them in half and squeezing them in his mouth.
Everybody. He's got all the business people.
Very sticky table.
Yeah. Everybody's in suits with like lobster bibs, orange bibs, I guess. And they're just squeezing halves of oranges.
Right. Yeah. Right off the tree. It's just great.
You can't have a business talk here because it's just like, and then I think we should move our drugs over. Spitting a seed out here and there. It's amazing. It's great, great shot.
Sonny's coming in. Because, of course, Sonny's too cool to have fucking orange juice splattered all over his. His suit costs at least $2,000.
Right. He's getting in some of that sun. He's sitting out by the pool. And that's when we see Celeste walking up on us.
Right. And they kind of...
She just slowly stands behind him and is making like soft noises, ASMR noises with her glasses right in his ear. And you're like, that's way too sexual for me. That's the kind of shit we're teaching kids in school these days.
So while Oscar and the boys are enjoying that freshly squeezed OJ, Miguel is all about business. He has the spreadsheets out. He's just like, we need to move immediately, Dad. We were disgraced at the party last night. And Oscar's like, this is called doing business, all right? This let it chill out.
Yeah, I already know what Elgato's getting up to. He's probably back at his base enjoying a nice brunch to keep his gut fed. Like, you're not thinking straight here, Miguel. You got to think straight. Dad, do you even read the graph? Left to right, X, Y coordinates? Are you understanding this? Should I put it in terms you can understand?
Should I put it in School of Hard Knocks terms?
Yeah. We're the orange, and he's squeezing us all over his face.
Wow, that was a great metaphor, Don. So, like, Miguel is like, we need more boats. We need more airplanes. We need more cocaine.
Right. We're talking about planes. We're talking about faster boats with, like, stickers on the side. We'll name them all.
Have them all. Well, we'll get some of those bolts. So I know you want like 14,000 bolts, but we'll get 6,000 bolts. No,
That's not enough. Look at the graph. Look at this. Look at the spreadsheet. Look at this PowerPoint thing that doesn't even exist yet, but will in the future. That's how good I am. It says we need 14,000 volts.
I think Miguel did invent the spreadsheet.
Yeah. I think he did.
Yeah. He was part of the, definitely part of the funding and part of the core team that designed Excels and spreadsheets. And it's amazing. I mean,
he went to MIT. We didn't.
Certainly didn't design hairstyles, did he, Miguel?
No. Ooh.
Well, that, no, that was hell of a design. That was great, but it was, he worked on it.
He popped.
So, like,
Conversation, like their debate, their argument over what is the right style.
How many boats?
How many boats?
How many planes?
Of course, it's, we've all seen this story. It's never going to end. So Sonny, negotiator, has to come in.
Well, no, this is what happens. This is the heat between Miguel, because instead of deferring to his son, Oscar always defers to Sonny.
Yeah, okay.
So he's like, Sonny, what do you think?
Right.
And Sonny's like,
he's trying to play both sides, though, like I said.
Right, yeah.
Because he's like, your son, Miguel, is right. We do need to get boats with names. We'll give you the names. Right. I don't get the branding part. They're drug boats. We're not supposed to be noticed, but you're right.
But here's the thing. Planes are great. Don't get me wrong, Miguel. But the DEA have their new radar balloons. They're going to see us. And the competition, they're all about the Stingers. They saw McBain, and they were like, Stingers are the future. And they'll shoot our planes out of the air. No planes. I think we should, like you said, he's playing in the middle. He's like, we won't get planes, Miguel, but we'll get more of those boats you want. So he like satisfies both Oscar and Miguel.
And you think it would be all over there, but Miguel still, he's trying so hard to one-up his dad. So he wants to get the last word in here. And Oscar's just like, you know what, son? I love you. Gets him by the face, you know, just doing the little taps on his cheeks, little tippy taps
on
his cheeks.
He actually got two orange halves and smashed them.
And just squeezed the juice out of it. Yeah. And he's telling him, someday, son, it will be your call. But for today, it's Papa's call. Yep. Walks out of the room. We're left there with just Sonny and Miguel.
And you can tell Miguel also respects Sonny. He's like, Sonny, why doesn't he understand? He's being a pussy. We need to get revenge. We're looking like pussies.
Right. And Sonny, he's like, yeah, I can feed into this a little bit here. You want to get revenge? I think I can work something out for
us. I got a few ideas I'd like to run by you.
Right.
So, this thing you call PowerPoint.
Yeah.
And that satisfies Miguel.
Right.
So Sonny goes to leave, and we see in the hiding in the like a shadows of a corner, it's Cliff.
Yeah. See, this is a scene where Wings steals the show, I think. That's why I don't think Wings would work well as the Cliff role. Because Wings, with those dilated eyes and that crazy hair, this guy, I think, did a better job of being, like, unsettling.
Well, he had that unsettling hair.
And always a bolo tie. I loved it.
Wasn't it always, like, a little undone to show how crazy he is?
Yep. He's a little undone. The hair's a little unkempt. Right. The bolo's
well, the
a
hair
little...
was obviously trying to hide like some balding. He was like it was all over
well,
the place.
This was the early 90s. Michael Jordan hadn't made it acceptable.
This was the mid 80s.
Oh, this is mid 80s.
This is like 80. Oh, this is very very early 90 when this aired. So it would have been filmed probably like 89 or something. But could we not have found a role in this episode for Ginty? Who would Ginty fit? Could he be a good
Somebody
Cliff King?
Shot? No.
Oh,
El Gato, maybe?
No.
No, 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 no. No, he would have been the informant who snitches.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, that's who he would have been. Except
he would have been great as the bathhouse guy.
Oh, you're... Okay, I like that.
If he's just like a towel attendant, he doesn't even have like a speaking role. He just hands... He's like, your towel, sir.
They just use his jowls to dry their hands, yeah.
Jowl and towel.
Jowl towel. Yeah.
I mean, I love Matt Frewer as Cliff King, but Michael Ironside could have nailed that role as well.
Oh, God. He'd have been
like Griff said with the Wings thing, he would have taken away.
Yeah, true.
Like, he'd be too good.
Yeah, this guy was the perfect...
He would have been good as Oscar, Michael Ironside. Mm.
Yes. Oh, yeah. I would have liked that, but again, I thought they were trying to go for, here's are the people that really stand out. We want Oscar to be a little bit more of a background piece.
Right.
Yeah.
So Cliff is like, I got some ideas of my own, you know? How about, you know, letting me in on this shit? And Sonny's just like, it's like,
because Cliff's thing, you know, he was the guy who went out and killed Elgato's brother. And so Cliff's thing is just, you just shoot the people dead before they can make a move.
He's a hammer, but you need a scalpel.
Right. And
he's
so,
the mechanic, isn't he? He's Cliff King.
Yeah. Yes. And he's not the subtle mechanic that Bronson is.
He's Jan Michael Vincent. Yeah.
He's full on Michael Vincent. I mean, maybe he used to look like Jan Michael Vincent. Maybe he used to have the hair, and that's why he's hiding everything, Murray. Good call.
It would be traumatic if you had some fucking Jan Michael Vincent hair.
Right. And you're left with that 10 years later. That's a tough career, though. That would make you go bald. So he's of course, just like, well, you might need a little extra muscle. And, of course, he's doing some hand-wringing and everything. Just to let you know how devious this motherfucker is. And muscle, why would I need muscle? Negotiators don't need muscle because that's Sonny's thing. Right. He negotiates. He talks people into things. Smooth talker.
This whole episode and this arc is like a chess game. You could say I think that's partly what I love about it is you can see Burnett just playing people off against each other, and you two can argue, and he's just weaving himself in and out of this huge sort of drug network, slowly rising to the top. Which obviously, when you watch the previous episode to that, it's exactly what he's doing in that one as well.
It's so good too, because every cop show, you're used to seeing the cop who's doing everything right, getting all the right results, getting yelled at, chewed out for everything. No, everybody's referring to Sonny. This is the perfect place for Sonny. He's killing it.
All right, back at the precinct, Tubbs has got some news from Castillo. He's like, I just heard over the wire that a munitions train had been robbed of Stingers. Who did it? Is it Elgato? Is it Carrero?
Is it McBain? Who knows? It could be.
Who knows? All I know is we're cutting to the perfect Ginty scene, a bathhouse. Mm. And we see two characters. Stuart, were these characters, were we supposed to know these guys, or are these new characters?
Yeah, these are new characters.
Okay. Because there's two guys, and this just shows you like how homophobic the 80s were, in that it's okay that these guys die because they're gay. They're kind of deviants, so it's okay. Because this is, I think, a brother of Elgato, isn't it?
I think so, yeah. It's definitely somebody close to the Elgato network.
Very, right. I mean, for the time, very provocative. Like this, I get surprised this made it into the TV show. Like,
Don knew what he was doing here. He was.
I mean, nothing happens. Nobody kisses, but the implications are there's going to be some fucking going on.
Exactly. You got this good looking man. You just see him from his chin up. He's got great hair, piercing eyes, and everything. And then he just reaches out. And another man walks up to him, and they're in a bathhouse. You know what's happening, everybody. Yeah, you know the implication. Baths, yeah. You think we're about to start the feet and scale, but don't worry, it's not coming out here. Neither are these men.
How did those like legally run? Because obviously everybody knows it's a hookup place to fuck. Who the fuck? I don't have indoor plumbing. I have to go outside my
Murray,
house.
Murray, it's
bathe.
Not. I know we live in America and everything's about. I'm doing this isolated by myself. Some people like to socialize in the nude.
Some people have like shoulder injuries from playing sports, and they need to go and get like a massage on the shoulder and have a swim afterwards, and just get buggered like you'd mentioned at the beginning.
Yeah, exactly. You got to relax. You got to get all relaxed before you get buggered.
Right.
So
he's bugging because all of a sudden in the background Sonny pops up.
Yep.
And we know Sonny's all man. He's not gonna be a part of this.
Not at all.
So does Sonny kill them, or is a goon of Sonny's? I don't remember.
Sonny kills them.
So I said, it's okay, they're gay. It's okay.
Yeah.
Yep. You know.
I like that sauna that they're in had the lit up floor.
Yeah.
Because
it's Miami. Classy.
Yeah, Don wanted the shot where there's blood all over the floor, and then you have the light, shining up through it. Good shot.
Yeah, I think they were in the same bathhouse from Revenge of the Ninja.
Yeah,
where they tortured people in the hot tubs.
Yeah, I thought I heard a door swing open. You could hear someone.
That
would have
been a greater scene if Sonny just boiled them in a hot tub, shooting them.
That could be like a whole nother episode. They could have strung it out even longer.
This is like a Dino Velvet sauna house. It's full of real king shit and all that.
So they die. All right, this is the greatest scene in the episode. We cut immediately to the funeral for this guy. We don't even know who the hell he is, but we do know who the mourner is. It's Elgato wearing his best gold beret? Like, was it a trench coat or was it just a jacket?
No, it was some sort of jacket type thing. I think he'd come away from his farewell, you know, under the candelabra type tour.
Yeah, he is very Liberace. He's got the gold LeMay jacket. He's got Macho Man Randy Savage shades.
Also gold.
He's wearing gloves with a ring on the fucking fingers.
Pinky ring, giant, like Super Bowl ring size. It was so big. And I was just like, is this his own collection?
And a giant eagle, gold eagle necklace.
Thank you for remembering that.
Yeah.
Isn't it the weirdest drug turf war, though? Because you've got the Carreras, who, you know, they're pretty much serious and focused, and they've got spreadsheets. And then the rival drug family is Liberace. It's a very strange rivalry.
It is, but hey, man, the drug world is a crazy world. So, of course, you're going to have very eccentric people at the top of them. Makes sense.
And he is distraught. He's like, you stupid fool, talking to the body.
Yeah, he slams the casket shut. This is what it's telling Murray. He has more than permission. He's ordered to do this at my funeral. Slams the casket. The casket falls over.
Right. And he's just like, they think they made us weaker, but this will only make us stronger. I want blood! Carrera's blood. And he swears he's going to get it.
That's all right. All right. So we're cutting over to Miguel, and here he is putting the moves on Celeste.
They're out poolside. Celeste is running. She's rubbing butter on her body.
Right.
And he's
that's right.
Yeah, and he's like
Australian grade sunscreen.
Yeah, or just it's just butter. Oh, that's what they call it in Australia. They call it sunscreen. It's just butter.
I thought it was the orange juice off the desk from the meeting room, but it might be butter.
He was trying to get her back onto the orange juice because that's what he's rubbing into his skin here.
Yeah, because Miguel is like, butter, it feels good, but it's going to baste you. It's going
to... Yeah, you kept calling him Kramer. It's ironic because Kramer used to use butter as sunscreen.
Exactly. Yeah.
So it's kind of funny that you said that.
Kramerero is his name.
Yeah. And so he's like, "That shit, you're just going to sizzle and it's not good for your body." I don't like things that are good for my body.
She's such a bad girl.
She's
such a bad stepmom, isn't she? It's like, really? I'm expecting like sort of 70s porno music to pop out anytime during these scenes.
You'll get that Wednesday. So you got that last week.
Oscar comes in. He's got some news. He wants to talk to Miguel. He's like, bitch, get the fuck out of here. This is men time, all right?
Yeah.
And she's all, huh?
But Miguel's trying to be her champion now because he went to a liberal college. So he's like, no. She has rights. Sorry, this is horrible. No, Miguel tries. It's just like anything you need to say, you can say in front of her. So speak up, old man.
She's part of the family.
She's part of the family.
And he's like, the fuck she is. She's some chick I fuck.
Yeah. See?
Get out of here, bitch. So they're fighting. And then we pull back. Great job by Donald Johnson, the director. And we see him standing in a doorway watching all this is Sonny. And Cliff. And fucking Cliff hands over $20 to Sonny. He's
right.
Like, I can't believe it.
Because that fight was getting to a fever pitch. And Oscar steps in Miguel's face and says, take a swing at me, boy.
You think you're man enough to hit your old man?
Let's go. Let's see it. Book smart, you little bookworm, starts pushing him around. I'm going to give you a fucking nuggie on that stupid head of hair of yours.
Right.
I will shove that ribbon up your ass.
This scene is to prove how much Sonny knows these guys. He's in their heads.
Right.
Because even Cliff is like, what a fucking bitch. I thought Miguel had some stones on him, but he let his dad talk to him that way. And Sonny's like, hey, you know, give me that 20. I knew it wasn't going to happen.
All right. So, sorry, everybody. These 50-minute stories, they tell a lot of story in a very small amount of time. So, we're going back to Elgato. He's in his limo. He's still
profusely sweating.
Oh, my God. Did they do some Kubrick, Friedrich level directing?
Freaking?
Did they put him in this limo and they're like, we want you to be really motivated. You're going to stay in the limo for 9 hours with the windows rolled up and someone's going to walk in and slap you a few times.
Well, it is Miami.
Keep those gloves on. Keep them on, though. You'll be taking those gloves off.
He probably couldn't get them off because they're like swollen out, you know, his fingers. Swelled, yeah. The ring locked it on. So he's in there sweating profusely. That That the gold chain never looked better, though.
Maybe that's the safest sauna you can have inside a limo. He learned from his brother.
That's why parents will leave their children in the car sometimes, or the dog in the car, because it's just like a sauna.
So he's getting some info from a guy who works for Carrera, who's like, yes, Sonny was the guy who hit your brother.
Yeah.
And then Gato's like, I want you to kill that fucking guy.
Yeah.
And sweeten the deal. I could see you rising up in our ranks.
Yes, yeah, I could see you making partner. And he extends that gloved hand with a limp little gesture, like, go on, my peon. Do my dirty work for me. See, this is the role I was saying Ginty would be okay in. The rat. The snitch. You know?
Yeah.
That's a Ginty role for you.
Yeah, you could immediately look at Ginty and go, I can't trust this guy.
Exactly. Yeah.
I mean, if you guys went to work for one of these organizations, wouldn't you rather go work for the Carreras? I would. It'd be a no-brainer. Really? No, you'd rather work for Elgato?
So much funner working for Elgato. You might get killed, but it's fun.
Right. He does.
Basically, and if you're in Carrera, everyone has to fuck with Celeste. There's only one woman they just pass back around. Elgato, shit. You don't know what's going on. You know, it's nonstop fun with Elgato.
I think Murray's right about that. The fashion, the uniforms are probably so much cooler.
No dress code. If I want to wear gloves with rings on the outside.
You probably cannot show up Elgato, though. That's probably the limit. Like,
yeah,
you,
no, you
I don't think
do
it's
that.
Possible.
I don't. Yeah.
Harry Styles keeps giving it a go nowadays. We've not quite got there.
Oh, that's a good call. Harry Styles is going for an Elgato sometimes.
Yep. So now we're back to the Carreras. Miguel and Oscar are still arguing.
Yep.
Cliff interrupts and goes, hey, this guy wants to talk to you, Cooper. He's got a business proposal for you guys.
But Oscar's not going to do any talking without Sonny.
Right.
And I think they have a little more history. He once worked for Manolo. Who the fuck's Manolo?
Yes.
Who the fuck's Manolo?
He's the guy who got killed in the last season.
Oh, okay.
Sonny was working for those birds.
Brother.
Right.
Oh, oh. Yeah.
Sonny's working for the rival. So, hey, did Sonny kill Manolo for Oscar? Is that what it was?
That we don't know. That never really gets touched upon. I think it's probably a case of Cliff King takes out Manolo, and that obviously means that Burnett's no boss anymore, so he's like, I'm going to go out for this other family. But that was all off screen. We don't know what happened.
Okay. So Mr. Cooper is going to show up, and I recognize this guy. I think I saw him about 15 minutes earlier.
Yeah.
It's fucking Tubbs. This is Tubbs. We got Sonny Burnett is Sonny Crockett's regular alias. So is Mr. Cooper Rico Tubbs' regular alias?
Yep.
Is it Rico Cooper?
Yeah, it's Rico Cooper and Rico Tubbs. Yep.
Okay. Because he's Sonny in both aliases. And he knows his cover. I'm black. I deal drugs. I got to be Jamaican.
Got to be.
Yep.
So like, hey, man, how's it going?
My boss, Kingpin, sent me here. Wait.
These blood clots we got all the way. He's going straight screw face on
us.
Screw face. Right?
That was what I was going for, yeah.
Right. And
go ahead, Stuart.
Yeah, I mean, what's bad is that we're obviously in season 5 of Miami Vice, and Tubbs has been doing this Jamaican accent on and off for like 5 years. So it is better now than it was in season 1, and it's still not great now. So he didn't get gunned down by any genuine Jamaicans, I do not know.
So we learned that his cover is he worked for Manolo. So Astra's like, get Sonny. Sonny worked for Manolo. He probably knows this guy. So Sonny walks up, and he doesn't recognize Cooper.
Yeah, they're having like a personal conversation here. Like, I don't think anybody else was really in the room for some of this talk.
And Cooper, they meet, and like he's like Sonny's do, like, I want to talk to you privately.
Yeah, they do the formalities, but Sonny, all business. So again, I didn't realize Sonny was in any kind of altered state. I thought he was deep undercover. So when Tubbs saw him, I was like, oh, these guys recognize. Because Don Johnson knows how to film eye acting, which is something not all directors know how to do. So the communication that was happening between their eyes was immense. It was intense. Immense.
And then now we're getting little flashbacks, which obviously I know because I've seen the previous episodes, but we're getting little flashbacks of Sheena Easton as Tubbs is talking to Burnett. Burnett's doing that thing where you're like, you kind of make sense, but I don't really know what you're talking about. So the use of the memory starting to come back is pretty clever.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because Tubbs thinks Sonny's undercover. So he's trying to get through to him. He's like, Crockett, what's going on? And
give me any kind of indication that Sonny Crockett is still in there.
And he gets nothing, even with all those flashbacks. We used to see the flashbacks of them together, him with Sheena Easton, and we're like, I don't know, he's gone. He's too far gone.
Right. So they shake hands. They're going to meet up in the next, few weeks or whatever to continue this deal. But Sonny goes on his way, and there's Miguel just standing inside but looking out towards the pool, and just like a David Lynch type of scene, Celeste is just outside dancing.
Yeah, this is cut to later in the night. So Sonny and Miguel are playing.
Oh, yeah, it was that night, yeah.
This is very, like you just, Stuart pointed out, Sonny's playing a game of chess. Now he's literally playing a game of chess with Miguel.
Yeah, we're going to learn that in a little bit here. Like, there's actually a game of chess being played. Because we just walk up and we're like, oh, they're, we obviously know Miguel's got the hots.
Right.
For Celeste. We saw it in the sunscreen scene. He's trying to get with her. He's trying to ASMR her ear. It's not working. Nothing's working. And so they're just both sitting there, sipping on some drinks, watching her dance.
Some
little Auberhorn style. No music playing. Just dancing around.
There's music playing.
Yeah,
there
was. Yeah.
Tony Childs sings that song. But we're also watching Celeste playing a game, not actually playing a game of chess, but she knows what she's doing. She's setting all the boys, to battle each other, and she's just going to cozy up with whoever wins the whole Lion King type fight. So I think everybody's playing games of chess in these episodes.
It's called the pussy fog, Stuart, and she is blowing in. You hear that foghorn go off in the distance.
Oh my God, that foghorn. You
but
should
Sonny,
hear
he's too good for that. He's got his fog blinders on.
That's, oh man, this episode, it's so good. That's what I thought was happening here. Sonny's like, I've seen this shit so many times. I'm not getting into this. Because every scene with Celeste and Sonny, I was just like, he's got his sights 10 miles ahead of Celeste. She's way behind him. So I was like, okay, this makes sense. Miguel, young kid, straight out of school. Of course he's going to be into this woman. Also, it's his dad's woman. Oedipus complex, man.
Sonny's like, I need to refresh my drink. It's a little brandy. As he turns around, he's like, do you want some? And then he sees Miguel made a beeline for Celeste, and they're dancing together by the pool.
Next morning, Sonny, apparently he's also kind of like a bodyguard situation, so he's at the beach. And we're getting more of those flashbacks.
He's wearing a suit on the beach.
As you do.
As you do.
The shade style.
Right. Yep. Celeste is getting out of the water. She's pulling her Ursula Andress and Dr. No kind of scene. And then Sonny, he's like standing on the docks. He notices a father and son on a jet ski. And that starts some other flashback memories. Did Sonny have a kid? I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. Sonny was married early on in the episodes. And they split up and the mother took the kid away. So it's one of those like, oh yeah, what happened to your kid? Oh yeah, I don't know. So you don't really see him for like a bunch of seasons, but that's his kid in the flashback.
Oh, okay.
I'm more worried about why didn't he have a flashback about Elvis his alligator? The alligator, did that disappear or was it throughout the whole series?
No,
he was in a houseboat and he had an alligator.
Oh,
yeah, it pops up now and again, just Elvis.
Yeah,
just for a bit here and there to throw it. Yeah.
I think Elvis with some shades on would have been perfect for this episode. like Elvis goes undercover as his alter ego.
Elvez is a bad alligator. That would have been amazing.
His name is Elvez because he's a Hispanic drug dealer. So I don't know. I'm putting it out there.
Yep.
I like it.
Celeste, it's revealed that Celeste, she's been working with Sonny by working Miguel. Sonny, she's one of his minions.
Right. She walks up, and this whole time I've been like, yes, Sonny's way over her. Like, he's seen light years beyond her. She walks up and lays a fat one on him, just starts going to town, tongue town.
Why? Because Sonny's the master of the smog.
Right.
His cock smog is controlling her. She's controlling Miguel with her fuck. He's controlling her with his smog.
Right. And so it turns out, just like a little marionette, he's using Celeste to dance around, shake her ass, get Miguel all in the fog. So she literally says, man, do you really think you have control over this family? They're falling apart. Yeah. And it's all our doing. And we're just going to keep pushing them a little further until, you know, I'm only helping them. They're already messed up.
Right. And she's like, I want to get the fuck out of here. It's like, hey, baby. He starts whispering promises of champagne and roses. And she just keeps doing what she's doing.
And then he tries to eat her face for some reason. Yep. I don't know why, but, you know, that's what happens.
It's romantic to people in Miami. That's Miami style.
That night, we see Sonny and Cliff out in the woods. And Cliff's like, you think you got ideas? Check out this surprise I got for you. And they walk
and
out
he takes
the
him dog. He takes him dogging, if that's a thing in America, where they all park in the middle of the woods, put the lights on, and then all do Celeste with a car bonnet. But that's
Celeste might be into that kind of thing.
She might well be. Yeah, I don't know what they call it in the US, but yeah.
I didn't know that was a thing. So
it's a thing in Britain. Yeah,
maybe it is a thing here. I don't know. We're not that sophisticated, apparently. They pull up in like their Jeep and they start flashing their lights into the absolute darkness, and then a bunch of cars flash back at them. It's like, oh shit, what's going on here?
They walk up on a bunch of goons. These are all of Carrera's drug runners. And Cliff's like, see, I got ideas. I can do things.
I thought Cliff was just muscle. So this,
right.
I was so impressed by this.
He is. He's an idiot, but he wants to be. He's not at Burnett's level, but he wants to be there. So he thinks he's like at their level.
Yeah. Yeah. He's proving he's not one of these people who just thinks, you know, he's not analytical. He's not total guts. He's got some progressive thoughts here.
Right. And Sonny makes them an offer they cannot refuse. He's like, look, trickle-down economics. Have you heard about it? If you guys work good, you work really hard, I'm going to give you all 10% of all your shipments. Not only that, how about this? Full health care. And I'm talking vision and dental.
Yeah.
Which if you heard that in America, you're immediately like, yes, sign me up.
Sign me up.
I can get dental, too. And so they're into it. They're like, he's basically trying to, it's socialism. I don't like that. I don't want socialism in my drug deal. And he's just like, like the sound of that.
Of course they like the sound of it. They're like, we get peanuts. So you're saying we get a cut. If we actually do harder, more work and make you more money, we get more money? That's right. Unheard of. And dental. And vision.
Yeah. Vision, too. Yeah.
Vision. You're kidding me right now.
And one of the guys, Pedro, he's like got a cataract, and he's just like, fuck yeah, sign me off.
So talk about the broest grab of all bro grabs. They shake hands on it. The union guy shakes his hand so fucking hard it almost rips it off Sonny's shoulder because he can't
so
wait.
So now Sonny's making his move to take over. He has all of Carrera's like drug runners under his control now. All right, we cut back to Carrera Mansion.
Celeste is
in her room, trying to sleep.
Oh, she wasn't trying to sleep. I thought she was watching. Oh no, you're right.
There's TV on.
Yep. TV was on. Okay.
And Miguel rolls in. He's got like a lace fucking Victoria's Secret ribbon in his hair. So you know what he's up for.
Yeah, he might have had some of her underwear pulled into her hair. He was real because he's trying to like. Get her into, you know, he's trying to weird it up for her.
Yeah, and he whispers, you know what I want.
I love that. That was his whisper voice. He's got no game.
And she's like, look, I don't want it. I'm not in the mood. Well, you will be in the mood. And he just forces himself on her. Oscar walks in.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
And he's like, what are you doing?
What the fuck is this?
Just giving mom a kiss goodnight. What's wrong with that? I don't know.
Talking
it's a family, isn't it?
Yeah.
But I mean, once you get one look at her undies tying his ponytail together, it's like, yeah, I don't think you're a kissing mom goodnight.
No.
So of course, another fight's gonna break out, and Miguel, he's a wuss. He can't go toe-to-toe with his dad.
His elderly dad.
Yeah. So he gets pushed over. He apparently, when he was kissing on Celeste, he grabbed her gun that she was pointing to him a second ago.
Yeah, she keeps a gun under a pillow.
Of course you do when you're in a drug house. Takes the, you know, he's got that gun. He falls over on the ground. Stop approaching me. Stop approaching me. Stand on my own ground. It's Miami. Shoots his dad dead.
Dad goes, well, a stuntman goes rolling down all the steps, like 5,000 steps. It's like fucking when Homer falls down the cliff and he doesn't make the jump. It's just blah, 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 blah.
It was like one of those barrels that go down in Donkey Kong. It reminded me of it. Gets to the bottom. People jumping over him as, you know, that's what I
Miguel, what have I done? No, papa, papa.
Shot your dad. That's what you've done. It's obvious you pulled the trigger, dumbass.
So you
that's exactly what Sonny says when he walks in.
Yeah, you got Celeste standing, you know, just outside of her room, looking down at Sonny, who's approaching the situation. Miguel's whispering into his dad's ear, don't worry, I'll take care of Celeste for you. I know you would have wanted it that way.
So, next scene, it's after the funeral. Like you said, he's in mourning. He has his black ribbon in his hair, and he's just hitting the bottle. A little glass, like half filled.
Usually, when you hit the bottle, it means you're going for a hard liquor, you know, just like Jim Brown did in Killing American Style. Yeah. He went for the soft stuff, though. He had, you know, a little bit of champagne, which usually, but
he's a champagne drunk.
Yeah. He's a champagne drunk, yeah. So he's, of course, upset. He killed his dad after all. And
he's got to shift the blame because he can't deal with it.
Right. Celeste, he sees Celeste walking by and she's taking her earrings off and I'm going upstairs. I'm getting out of this. I don't look my best in black. It just doesn't work for me.
To be fair, it does work for her, to be honest.
Yeah, she looked great.
I thought, yeah.
Miguel, what the fuck was he wearing? This is a funeral. He's wearing this like crazy like prince outfit. Dude.
Yeah.
It was black. I'll give him that.
Yeah, it was.
He made an effort. The ribbon was black. It's fine.
Yes.
Yeah. And so he sees her getting up. No, you're going to mourn. You're going to drink some champagne and mourn with me. Goes over, grabs her, and starts slapping her because he doesn't know what to do with his emotions, not to excuse him. And so Sonny, of course, has to play the level-headed bouncer. Oh, shit. Can't think of the goddamn movie that I'm trying. Bouncer? No.
Roadhouse.
Roadhouse. Thank you. God, what do they call him in Roadhouse?
Coolers.
He has to play the cooler. Whoa, there, Tyson. He's off a little bit.
Iron Mike is what he called.
Iron Mike? That was it. Okay, thank you.
But and he, obviously Celeste is upset, so he's got to calm her. He sits him down, pulls out a little bit of the booger sugars, like, here, this will calm you down.
Right.
Cocaine will calm you down.
It always does, yeah.
So. And it's a funeral, so it's black cocaine, which was quite a nice touch as well. So.
It was.
Very, right. Very respectful. A little black baggie, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And so Sonny is going to whisk Celeste away just to the other side of the room.
Because his plan is almost done. He still needs her.
Right.
So he's got to calm her down.
Celeste is very upset by the situation, but Sonny's like, I got to go take care of some stuff, but I just need you to go over there, give him a little shoulder to cry on. Maybe
blow
a little
pussy fog his way.
Just right in his ear, a little bit of that
ASMR.
She's
like, I can't handle this. These guys are fucking creeps. I can't do this. And then Sonny does a little cock smog in her face.
Right. She has one moment where she's like, no, it's not working this time, mister. You're turning into one of them. But with that stern, cooler voice of his, he tells her, I'm nothing like them. I'm the top of the pop.
Yeah. They're a joke.
He's all right. The
coolest character ever, this Burnett, in this episode.
So he's like the man of the fucking house now. He's like, I got a meeting I have to go to in my chopper. So he heads out to the chopper, and then we see a very Ginty-esque looking guy watching on. It's a guy that Elgato's snitch.
It's his informant, his snitch.
So Sonny's meeting is with it's Presidente Escobar from McBain.
I recognized him. His fly was still down.
Right. And we learned he apparently runs all of Mexico, which they need because they need they need to get the border. They need the trucks with the fruit in it that they hide the cocaine in.
Right.
And he wants to make a deal with the guy. His name is Escobar. He goes by Salazar when he's a drug dealer.
That's right.
And he's like, this sounds like a great idea. They're sitting down. They're outside. There's a trap door opens up, and he starts getting a blowjob. I don't know what was up with that.
Don Johnson made sure to get that shot, too. He really wanted people to connect it to McMahon. It was great.
Well, yeah, that's why there's stingers. Here. Yeah.
Probably filmed around the same time, to be fair.
Yeah.
If you look at the years. So he just walked from one set to the other.
And he's like, Mr. Burnett, I like what you're saying, but there's one small problem. El Gato. Can you get him out of the way?
I love this. Yeah, I love when you start using like hidden language here because he's like, I need you to grease him. Boil him down into a puddle. What does that mean?
And Sonny, he looked pretty greasy in that limo. So.
And then you grind him into grease so then Celeste can rub him all over her legs.
There we go. Oh, and that'll black the sun.
That's what it is. That's how you get rid of bodies. You just turn them into suntan oil and then smear them all over women's legs. Yep.
And Sonny's like, I think I can do that. So, all right, they got the deal. He's ready to take over the fucking business.
Yeah, Sonny's got everything worked out. He's got a few loose ends to tie up here. He's heading back in, nighttime at the Carrera Estate. He's walking in with Cliff. They're both just like high on all the action they've been, all the deals they've been getting done. And that's when Celeste steps out of whatever room she's been hanging out.
Well, as they're walking up to Celeste, Sonny's like, that Cooper guy, what's going on with him? And he's like, his story pans out. He's legit. We can work with this guy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And that's
and
when
Sonny's like, there's something off about that guy. I can't put my finger on it, but okay. And that's when we see Celeste. She's got a fuck room all set up with candles and everything.
She's got a fuck room on every level of this house, in every corridor, and it's incredible.
It looked like it was in a lighthouse or some shit. What was going
on? Yeah, no, that's where the meeting was. They were doing the meeting between.
This was
Burnett
a weird room too. It was like a brick kind of.
Yeah, it was like a guest house whatever.
And she's waiting to get fucked.
Well, she's upset because it's like, I've been waiting all night long. You're so late. And he's just like, well, why don't you just drink another bottle of champagne and pretend I showed up on time? Whew.
Don't tell that to a woman.
She didn't like that.
Throws the champagne bottle at Sonny, gets some of that shit on his fucking $2,000 suit, runs up to him, punches on him, calls him a punk. But he still keeps it cool, man.
Cooler. He's a cooler. Yep. He went to the School of Sways.
What have we always said, Griff? The way to a woman's heart is by making her furious and angry at you.
Hate is the greatest aphrodisiac.
Yes.
I'll try that tonight once I finish the podcast. I'll let you guys know how it goes. Wish me
please
luck.
Do. Will please do. Do.
Yeah.
We'll have you on like a love line next week. We'll call you up and who is this? Stuart's on the line. How's your love life, Stuart?
Love life. I got killed. She killed me.
So of course things are getting very hot and heated in this room because when it's like
there's a lot of candles, it's very hot.
It's like the incredible hurricanes. You get the cold front, the warm front.
Hurricane
you got the
Celeste is coming through.
Exactly. You got the warm and the cold and they're under and over and oh my god. It's a rainstorm, a fucking tsunami breaks out in that room.
Yeah, it's a whole climate change thing going on there.
That's right.
There's a lot of global warming going
on.
There
is a lot of moisture and heat rising and stuff. Yep.
The ocean floor rose a few inches in that room.
It did. Right. Dawn's like more than a few inches.
The result might be an El Nino. The jet stream is flowing. All I'm saying.
Yep.
All right. Back at old Miami Vice Precinct. Tubbs is ready to do that meeting, but Castillo wants him to have backup. And he's like, no, I thought I was doing this solo. I work alone. That's the best way to work when you're a cop in a dangerous situation is work alone.
It's too big. We've got to go in with everybody.
He's like, Crockett is unpredictable. He's like, and then Tubbs like, no, you're right. Sonny's just not Sonny anymore. I'll just have to handle him if he gets in the way.
All right. We know what Tubbs going to be doing tonight. But we know
what Crockett just did.
Yeah. Yep. And that is one satisfied woman.
Right.
I mean,
she wants more, and he's just like, get off of me, you know.
The outfits, his outfits all relaxed out now. He's got the unbuttons, ties mostly.
Shirt tail hanging out his pants.
Ponytail's gone. The hair's like out now. Yeah. It's done.
It's flowing. Yeah.
The only other time he had the ponytail out when he was on the beach with her.
Yeah.
So that's your sign that he's been fucking Celeste. Ponytail out.
Right.
So he's ready.
He's still got that meeting with Cooper.
And we know this from Iron Mike himself. You don't fuck before a big drug deal. Like you get weak legs. Yeah. Like you got
cheese depleted. It's not a good situation.
Exactly.
So as they're walking out, Miguel comes in. That's my woman. How dare you? I thought I could trust you, Sonny.
I knew it. I knew you'd been fucking her. I saw the way you looked at her.
He pulls the gun.
But you looked at her when she was with your dad. So shall we talk about morals, Miguel?
Oh. Why do you call her mommy still?
Exactly. But, you know, whatever works.
Pulls a gun on Sonny. Sonny's like, be cool, baby. Be cool. We can talk this out.
Right.
And they pull that. Want some of this? Peruvian marching powder.
Peruvian marching powder.
And he starts licking his lips. He's like, gimme, gimme, gimme.
And that's when Celeste just goes, Sonny. And Sonny knows to hit the deck. Celeste also hits the deck. And then it just so happens that microwave timing is incredible here.
Isn't it?
Because Sonny hits the deck, and from behind him, the informant with his scope.
He's got a Pliskin 450. It's a fucking revolver with a fucking scope on it.
Yep. And it shoots. It was meant for Sonny. Sonny dodges it without even looking, and it hits Miguel.
Miguel falls in like a wishing well.
Miguel, whatever guy they got to do this stunt, he fucking takes that bullet to the heart, and then he does like three different pirouettes. Does a nice little forward flip, tumble.
It was a Shervan death.
It really was.
Yeah. Well, keels over. Sonny, of course, takes out the assassin.
Oh, yeah.
Military-style shooting comes back. Does a little crawl. Sandy blonde hair's out again. Bang, takes out the really fast-triggered assassin, I might add. It's like, I'm going to shoot this person. They've just ducked. They've moved out of the way. Bang. Oh, no, got somebody else.
Yeah, he really was just like savoring his kill. Like, wow, I did that. Was it his first kill?
I'm guessing so. It was certainly his last kill.
Yeah, well, yeah. He's basically, so, in the world of mechanics, he's a Jiffy Lube guy. He's Cliff's like, what the fuck's going on? He's like, oh shit, this guy did a job for us. We don't even have to kill Miguel now. This is pretty awesome, Sonny.
Yeah, man, everything is just coming up us. It's amazing.
So now Celeste
was like, no, everybody's coming up me, I think.
Coming on her.
They were, yeah.
So Sonny is like, I got a deal to make. So now we're meeting at the lighthouse. And we see Cooper, Tubbs, walking into this lighthouse. For a lighthouse, it's very dark.
Very dark.
That's very metaphorical.
Yeah.
And he's just like, where's your boss? He says that to Sonny. I'm afraid Oscar fell down the stairs. And Stubbs like, Sonny, we're alone. Don't you recognize me? It's Tubbs.
No, he doesn't say that. He doesn't say that. Oh. Don't you recognize me? I'm Rico. Hello?
Flashback rolls in where we see these two guys. They probably do this every episode. And say how much they love each other. They would die for each other. And then a bulb goes off in Sonny's head. He's like, ah, yes. You're Tubbs.
We cut down to the base where the guards are hanging out outside the light tower, and then we hear gunshots.
Boom. Hey. Who this got is... killed? Did Sonny die? Did Tubbs die? Well, you're going to have to wait till the next episode. Yes, this is a part two, Tippy Tap.
It is.
We haven't finished the story, people.
That's right.
We don't even know Stuart knows.
Many times I know what happens on this, but you guys don't. I'm so envious.
I'm so excited to finish this. I'm so into this. It started a play when I had it on earlier, and I had to go stop it because I want to be right. fresh for that shit.
So everybody, this you're gonna get a taste of what we were just talking about, where a young Stuart had to wait 3 months until the next season started. Well, he had to wait a week, I guess.
Yeah, that would have been.
But still, that's almost like 3 months.
That's almost. Yeah.
In dog years, that's three months.
Right.
And so you're gonna feel the same way. I don't know when we're gonna get our schedules back together. Yes.
next August or something.
We're gonna finish this.
It might. Shit, we gotta try to get it in September before Schlocktober starts.
That's true.
Are you doing
anything at the end of this month, Stuart? Are you available?
Yeah, I don't think I'm doing anything. Beginning of October, I am, but not anytime in September or the very first few days of October.
Good.
Okay. All right.
All right, so stay tuned for the end of September. We'll finish up this episode. I'm going to let Griff, as always, see us out. Stuart, great seeing you. It's going to be great to see you again because we're going to be back together.
I can't wait. I know. I always look forward to chatting with you guys. Been a pleasure, as always.
Well, unfortunately for everybody, we didn't get a cop a full feel, Stuart, this week. No. But we got one cheek. We're getting that other cheek next week. Yeah. And until then, class, if you have any questions, I'm listening.
Yeah, I'm going to go put my ponytail back in.
There's a surprising amount of Tubi features. Like this whole Miami Vice is completely on Tubi.
Is Shakespeare on there? Because that'd be like Tubi or not Tubi. No?
Don't save that for the podcast. Keep this.
It's just
it's appropriate.